Thank you. So, as we have the movie night tonight, I want to get you warm up. I brought a science fiction movie.
Let's take a look at the sort of facilities we can give him. Worldwide communication, of course.
Hello, Bill. This is Henry.
Who did you say?
Henry. I'm calling from London.
Gee, that's a pleasant surprise. How are things in your part of the world?
It's a dark, wet morning here. I suppose you've been basking in the sun all day.
And, when we want it, view phone, in colour. Using digital transmission by pulse code modulation right into the customer's premises.
Well, let's have a look at you, Bill.
Right, Henry, picture coming up.
Gee, it's good to see you, Henry. You're certainly looking fit.
How's Betty, Bill?
She's right here now. Come over here, Betty, and say hello to Henry.
Hello, Henry. Long time no see.
But we can do much more than that. Library services, transmission of documents, share prices, bank statements. Let's take a look at the subscriber's terminal unit. To make a call, we take our service card. The code will be scanned electronically and establishes the caller's identity for charging the call.
Yeah. And then
as she keys, the digits appear on her viewphone screen.
Some ship arrives in the harbor or something. So this is seriously a science fiction movie. It's a prediction of the future from the 60s. Of the postal office. Can you hear me well? Okay. And what is really cool about this one is it predicts the future like in a very normal, boring manner. Like not the very shiny, you know, future prediction by Microsoft and Apple and so on, where like we all live in glass houses and have transparent phones without battery and everything. And here, when you see this, like she actually made a mistake, right? Well, like in the beginning, they talk about the weather and stuff. It's a very good prediction. And it's also an excerpt of a talk about Offline First by Alex Fejerke from the Hoodie community, who did great talks on a like meta level. It gives very good background on where Offline First comes from, and it's very good arguments to persuade like decision makers, clients. And I say that because my job today is to make you excited about Offline First, and I hope you get home and take like 50 minutes and give it a try because it's really cool and it's fun. And then if you need to persuade them, look at the talks by Alex, and you will get all the arguments you need. I will link them in the notes when I upload the slides. So, hey, I'm Gregor. As Adam mentioned, I'm coming all the way from Zurich, and I'm very, very grateful, you know, that you brought me all the way here, and I really appreciate all the efforts by Claire and Adam and all the team from Boku and everyone else that's involved, and they're just giving me the chance to talk today about Offline First and Hoodie. So I am one of the people behind the Hoodie project. So Hoodie is not a company, really. Hoodie is an open source project. There is a company also affiliated with it, but it's called the Neighbor Hoodies. I'm very, very grateful. Like, this is a very, very cool team that we put together. Some of them are developers, and some of them are also illustrators, like artists, communication people. And I think we do quite a good job, at least like my perspective, on not only, you know, putting efforts towards the technology, but also the entire culture about this open source project. We care a lot about this. And you're more than welcome, if there's anything you want to ask, to ping me directly or like ask me after the talk. I'm very happy to help you with whatever it is. And Hoodie itself is a server. Like, it's an open source web server, really. So it just can serve static assets. But above that, it also has an API for data storage and user authentication out of the box. And it has a plugin architecture that you can extend with whatever functionality you would need. And what is special about it is that if you use Hoodie's APIs, your apps will work offline out of the box by default, which is why we are so interested in this topic and which finally also brought me here today. And I want to dive right in. I don't want to do like the high level stuff. I don't want to kind of push you that offline first is super important and you have to go there. I actually want to show you how easy it is and how fun. And yeah, let's dive right in. I hope this works. So this is like a traditional application that I just built very quickly. sorry. So it has a RESTful API. Like you can see when I make changes, I don't really see the video in front of me. It's a bit whatever. So if you make changes, you see on the right that, you know, like for every change to an account, like just a REST, an HTTP request is being sent. And I can like favorite contacts. I can edit them. I can create new contacts. I can sign out and sign back in, and the data gets persisted. And as I sign in, the data gets bootstrapped again. All right, and this is a very, very simple application. It's also on GitHub, so I will link it as well. It's what I will take, and I will make it offline first now in a minute. It only uses one collection and one model and a few views, so it's really, really pretty simple. How we turn this into an offline first app is I will show you how to create a Hoodie application at first. Does the video start? So I made a video of it because I wasn't sure about the internet connection, and as I talk about offline, I kind of it would be pretty funny if, you know, my talk wouldn't work because of internet connection. So I made the recording, but after that I would actually code myself. And what you see here is once you have the Hoodie CLI tool installed, you can do Hoodie new and the app name. It will take a little bit. It will download all the required modules from the internet. And then create like a basic standard application. And then I CD it into the folder. And then I installed the Backbone plugin, which gives us some nice kind of API. So we can use special kind of Hoodie models and collections which do the wiring for us, and we don't have to do it anymore. So I can now, I hope that this will work. Give me a second. Can you see my screen? Okay, so we are in this folder right now, and I need to make a few changes. So this is the standard application that comes with Hoodie that we can get rid of. And instead, we use the assets from the application that I showed first. So just like copy and paste of the static assets. And I put them in here, one to one. And now I need to adjust a few things here. First, I need to load Hoodie. Sorry. So Hoodie comes at a special URL. It's API files Hoodie.js. So this is like the bundled JavaScript code of Hoodie core and also the plugins. So it will automatically have the backbone code that I just installed. And then I need to initialize it. So I do Hoodie equals new Hoodie. And besides that, I need to adjust the models and collections. So instead of, you can all read this, okay? I do simply Hoodie backbone collection, and I do Hoodie backbone model. And that's pretty much it. I should now be able to do Hoodie start, which will start the server, and then it should also start the browser, exactly. Oops, sorry, where is this? So you have the very same application now, just with the difference, like if I add some data here, you don't see any requests at all. So kind of like just by, you know, flipping out the collections and the models, it's already working, and you see it like in local storage is where Hoodie stores its data right now for offline usage. And there is no like requests, because why should there? What's also different is when I opened the app, there was no login form. right? I jumped right into the application. And this is possible because of the app logic is there. The data can be stored offline, so there is no really need to require the user to sign up before he can use the app or she. You can just jump right in. So right now it has still the like the sign out button. Let me show it to you. Come on. Okay, whatever. So it still has the logout button, which doesn't make much sense anymore. So I made another application, which is kind of the same. All I did is I added a new view to it, which is not really interesting, so I just prepared it. I do hoodie start here as well. I hope this doesn't look right. Okay, now. So now you see there is an account view now here, which means I can, you know, like create whatever new contacts and all the stuff just as I did before. I can now sign up for an account. Sign up. And I can open up another browser, which I simulate with a private browser mode. Here as well, I could even add like whatever, another contact. And like after I use the app, I could sign up or I could sign into the same account, which will then only if I, you know, start using the authentication, will start synchronizing the data for me, right? So I can like just create another user here, and there is no kind of special thing I need to do. It will just start to synchronize the application. What it does not have yet is offline, like the data works offline, so it's kind of half path through. The other part is to make the application logic work offline as well. So we can simulate this with this beautiful Chrome DevTools. I don't know if Firefox has it by now as well. So if I go offline here and reload the page, it doesn't work, right? What you need to do is, I forgot to show you, I installed another plugin, which is Hoodie install app cache. So I already did that, it's already there, and it exposes another API for me, which is Hoodie app cache, and it has some methods, and one is called start. And what Hoodie app cache start does is it caches all the assets offline, and it also starts checking for new updates. So if while the application is open and a new update comes up, I can react on it. Like maybe some of you have heard, I built like this offline app for the conference, like this one really. If I would push like a schedule update, at some point you might see a little overlay saying like, hey, there is an update, you need to reload the app. So now you already see in the console here that he cached all the assets. If I go offline now and reload the page, it will just work. I can create like here, I could create an offline contact. And here for like just demo purpose, an online contact. So here's my online contact and here's my offline contact. And then at some point, you know, maybe I was in a tunnel or something. I get internet again, and it just starts synchronizing eventually. So that's the whole point. And also maybe in short demonstration, like well, let's say I would be on a very bad internet connection, like GPRS, like the worst that I can demonstrate here. It doesn't really matter. Like the application is super responsive, no matter if there is synchronization or not, because it's entirely decoupled. Like the UI is very, very responsive. If you want, you can save every keystroke, for example. So it's very, very robust. Even if it crashes, it won't lose data, which gives you all kind of interesting benefits. Okay, back to live. Back to Okay, just to give you a short recap, what I did is I installed a new Hoodie application with the first command. I installed the Backbone plugin, and I put like all my static assets into this www folder. I started the Hoodie server, and that was it to kind of create my Hoodie application. This is what it takes. And then I loaded the bundled Hoodie.js to it, and I initialized Hoodie, and then I used the Hoodie backbone model and collection. That was the first part. And for the second part, for the actual app logic for the assets, I installed the AppCache plugin, and I kind of started the process of checking for new updates. And then there's this kind of here's a code for the UI sugar. So AppCache has certain events that it triggers, and if you listen to the update ready event, it means that in the background a new version of the application has been downloaded, and you can react on it and inform the user if you decide to, and if not, it will work anyway just after the next reload. So that was really, really simple. Like, besides all the demo, it probably would take 2 minutes to set this up with the backbone and the AppCache plugin. So really, if there is one thing I want you to get out of it, is the technical part of offline first application, at least in the scope of these use cases that fit here, are very, very easy, and there is no reason not just to go ahead and do it. Like, the challenges are somewhere else, really. Sync is a hard thing, but there are good solutions for this. The real challenges are more on the user experience part. I will talk about this in a bit. And if you decide to do it, you also get some really cool benefits. So it's really, really fast, as I showed you, right? We put all these crazy efforts with these distributed CDN networks to move assets as close to the user as possible. But really, what's closest to me is my phone. And if you put your assets here, it's literally zero latency, and there is nothing that can compete with that. So it's a cool side effect. Another one that I mentioned is you have new possibilities to engage with your users. Like, usually today you have these marketing pages and they have videos and everything what's possible to kind of convince the user, you know, to enter an email and a password, some even like already a credit card. You can stripe all that. Like, if your app works offline first, like, if you want, you have a 100% conversion rate because you can jump right in into the application, which is really, really cool. Yeah, it's the crazy nasty ass honey badger. So it's super robust, right? Like, whatever happens, you usually, if you build offline first and you follow the architecture, there is no need, there is no real case for freezing UIs. There's no like, there's no really need to block the UI to sync or like to download updates or something. You can just work, and you can work with it. You can create new data, no matter the internet connection, because it's a separate concern. Of course, it works everywhere. Like, this is the obvious thing. It works like in the subway. It works in the plane. It works for me. You know, I like my provider kind of charges me $1 per megabyte if I use internet here, so I'm kind of offline until I buy like a SIM card, of course. And also, for example, things that if your server is down, right? Like, we have an app in production, like an offline first app in production since a few years, and usually we don't even tell our users if we have any maintenance because they don't know, like they don't even realize. You know, we maybe get some emails about, hey, I cannot sign in, like what's up, right? But even if they cannot sign in, they can still use the app and sign in later, and the data gets migrated in. Another aspect that I find very interesting, and it's maybe not obvious, but offline first or like offline capable applications could play an important part to decentralize the web. At least in Europe, kind of providing solutions that bring also data ownership has by now a very high economic value. So like, companies really ask for it. And if your application works offline, it means that you could easily make solutions where you put servers in your enterprise network or like in your private home, and all your data will synchronize, which lives up to the user expectations of today. Like, we expect our data to be on our computer, our phones, our tablet, everywhere, right? At the same time, if you leave this network, although you are connected to the internet, your app is still offline. Your app works still offline, and it's not a problem because it's made for it. So it's a very interesting use case, also like for enterprise software, and I hope that this will be kind of the monetary driver for this movement. Offline first, and at least with Hoodie, it's a lot of fun. Like, I mean, there are other projects in this field, but I really hope to achieve with Hoodie is to set the bar of the experience for the developers. And I hope once you had Hoodie, you will not go with worse API. So there's a lot of pressure, and I hope that this will kind of drive the whole adoption of these more robust apps. Because think about all the stuff that I didn't do. Right, I created the Hoodie app. So I didn't write a single line of backend code. I didn't set up a database. I didn't like do any schema for a database. I didn't configure any user authentication. It was all there. Like, I had my app running and it was working offline in a few minutes. So even if offline capability is not a use case for you, it still maybe be interesting to use it anyway because of ease of use, because of the experience for the developers. And this is what we put the most effort in at Hoodie. And because it's open source and because it has a plugin architecture, you could easily extend it with whatever you need. So if you would need to, I don't know, like send emails, you install the email plugin, and then you have a JavaScript method saying Hoodie email send, for example. Or you could integrate with third-party services like Basecamp. Like, you can do whatever. These are just node modules that expose the front-end API usually. So how does this work? There is really nothing special to it, right? So this is the kind of standard way that you would initialize a model, or like define a model and collection anyway. This is how you would create a new record and backbone. You have the events you can listen to, and then Hoodie or the Hoodie plugins expose additional APIs that are used here, for example, for user authentication that kicked off the synchronization. And if you look at this API, you might wonder, like, okay, but where's the offline? Like, how do I know, you know, that this works offline? It doesn't tell anything. Even if you look at the kind of Hoodie store API that is used in the plugin internally, it also doesn't expose any kind of offline, like, methodology or variables or anything. But that's also really the point. The thing is, like, offline capability is really a generic problem. So we thought we can kind of make a generic solution for it so you don't have to think about it. And if you just use Hoodie because of its ease of use, you just get it for free. You don't have to worry about it. And it's a cool hack, you know, to bring more of these architectures into the field. So what's behind the API? I will give you a short insight into how the architecture works, or how a typical offline architecture works. So first, there are two things, you know, that we really need, as I demoed in the beginning. For one, there is the app and its assets. And for that, in this example, I used application cache, which is a native model, a native object available in all browsers today, like starting IE10, I think. And now Service Worker, you might have heard of, is coming, which will be even way more awesome. It gives us way more control and interesting possibilities. Also, you could do native wrappers like PhoneGap, Node WebKit, or obviously like native applications have this problem solved by nature. And the other one is the data. And the app must handle the data in a way that it doesn't require a connection. And this is done by writing a reading through a local database, kind of, and then have a separate process that synchronizes it. And for the local storage in the browser today, you can use local storage or IndexedDB. You could still use WebSQL, and you can use abstraction libraries like local forage from Mozilla, which is really good. PouchDB, or you can use a high abstraction level like Hudi provides it. So let's see how Hudi handles that. Hudi's saying this is how kind of Hudi does offline and everything, really. So there's a front end and a back end part to it. And first you have the app. This is pretty much like the assets that I copy and pasted in the beginning. And the app only talks to the Hudi Store API. It never talks directly to persist data. It never talks directly to the server. It never talks directly to like the local storage API. It only talks to the Hudi Store API. And the Hudi Store API then takes care about persisting this data locally in the browser. And if you look at that, you might realize that probably this is already enough. Like, if you go offline first, you might realize, I don't even need the user's data, or I don't want it, or I don't want all of it, right? So probably it's a new opportunity, you know, to consider when you build applications today. But let's think about, or let's assume we need synchronization. So what's happening is that the Hudi Store API talks to the REST API of CouchDB, which has a replication API, which takes care about keeping the local storage and the user's database in sync. So this might sound weird, but every user has their own database in CouchDB, which is a very common pattern. It's a very cheap operation. So kind of the decision on what to sync is very easy. You just synchronize everything because all data in this one database is private by the user. And then the CouchDB has a changes feed. So like plugins can subscribe to changes in the database and can pick up stuff like sending an email, for example. So what would happen now if I would, let's say I would do the example, I send an email. So in my application code, I would call Hudi email send and then pass the properties to send the email. This would just be stored as a JSON among all the other data in the local storage and then synchronized like all the data to CouchDB, to remote. And there it would get picked up, like the email kind of plugin would be informed and it would try to send the email. And if it worked, it will update the object. If it failed, it will update the object as well and say there was an error. Because of this update, the synchronization gets kind of triggered again back to the front end. And there I can trigger an event which lets me as developer inform the user like, hey, your email has been sent successfully, or there was an error, here's what happened. And what's really cool about this is that in most cases, the front end doesn't really care if the back end is there or not, or how fast the internet connection is. It will just hang on, you know, it will just kind of continue to work, and the users usually don't tell. It's up to you as a developer to decide if you want to inform your user. I have to laugh, like everyone is closing their eyes. You must be tired, huh? Yeah, bear with me. Wait a second. Okay, offline badger. So, yeah, you know, we like to think about like offline apps being kind of the web's honey badger, really, because it doesn't care. Like bad internet connection, I don't care. I just work. Like no internet connection, bees, tunnels, like doesn't matter, right? The server is down. Like what do I care? And this is how, you know, the Hudi apps work. And I think that this is how really all applications or like whole life really should work. Like this is why the first video was good, because they made examples of what goes wrong. Like they don't understand each other in the beginning, or you made an error when you type something. And all our applications, they fail in ways we could not anticipate today. Like we have no ideas. So what's good about this kind of architecture is it's built for that. Like it's built for eventual connectivity. It's built for, you know, a surrounding that is not kind of the everyone has 4G kind of environment that really doesn't exist today. And yeah, so oh yeah, I like it really. Like Alex coined this architecture is like passive aggressive roommates. You know, like they don't really talk to each other. They just leave like letters, you know, like who ate my yogurt and, you know, clean up the dishwasher. Yeah, I like this a lot. But what's really, really hard about us is the synchronization part. And I really ask you, don't go and, you know, start creating your own synchronization engine, because I've been there. I, you know, kind of did the local storage self-cooked thing, and it's really, really hard, which is also why we're moving to Pouch2B now. But it's also the reason why we use Couch2B as our backend, because Couch2B is a database that syncs, and that's exactly what we want. It has a very, very nice replication API, which has been re-implemented in other projects, like Pouch2B, which is kind of Couch2B in the browser. There is Touch2B for Android, iOS. And also, I think just 2 days ago, Drupal announced they will expose a Couch2B-compatible API to, you know, become a platform for offline-first applications. So even if it's not Couch2B, it's enough to expose this kind of replication API. So yeah, there's Pouch2B you should definitely check out. Like, if Hoodie is too high level, you need lower level control, definitely look into Pouch2B. Remote storage is another interesting project because it's bring your own backend approach. So it's the idea that every user has their own backend. You just go to a URL, for example, download an application, just the static assets, and then connect it to your own backend, which might be, you know, at home, or which even might be an application that's running on your computer. It's really, really cool. There's even JS Git and all kind of other stuff. But no matter what, like, don't make your own synchronization thing, really. Yeah, so there's a really good quote, I think, that explains not only why offline is important, but also why it's called offline first. You know, like, for my example, I kind of took something that existing and made it offline first, but it was only possible because it's so simple. Like, offline compatibility is something that is very, very hard to add afterwards, because it's an entire architecture that you need to follow from the beginning. So, like, for Hoodie, we really fell into this by chance. It was by accident. Like, Hoodie was extracted from an application that worked offline, and we really focused on the API part. The offline part was kind of just came with it. And only later on, we realized we are onto something here. We have an interesting solution, and we thought that we will ask around a little bit if this is a subject, you know, that people are interested in. That was around the time when I was in Africa. So I traveled through the capitals, you know, of Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, Tanzania for 6 weeks, and I met the tech communities there. And they have a lot of interesting kind of offline first business opportunities, really, like a lot of point of sale systems, for example, because when there's an internet outage, there is an electricity outage, there is internet outage, and if the system depends on internet, you can shut down, you know, your shop, for example. And they also, like, there are some projects that go in this direction as well, like Hoodie. Then Alex wrote a very nice article on it, which you should read if you haven't yet. It's like the first thing, gives an introduction and our perspective on it. And this kind of picked up in the community, you know. I really liked how Jeffrey Zeltman said this is the new progressive enhancement, because it really fits the offline first thing. It's not something that you do afterwards. It's not like you have an application and you degrade it to kind of handle offline as a problem. Like, you only can get this far, like, it just won't work. And then Alex wrote another article on the list apart, and it got an even more traction. And like, some of us, we've been traveling, like, invited to conferences like here to talk about it, which is very, very nice. We've been at the Mozilla Fest in London and made a workshop with 40 people. We made another one in Berlin shortly afterwards. And we talked to all these people and kind of were gathering ideas and thoughts. And it was really interesting to see that a lot of people have similar issues but really didn't talk about it. Like, this one felt like offline first anonymous meeting. It was like, I felt like a lot of people have this. I have an issue because... Okay, excuse me. Yeah, a lot of people have this issue, but there was not really a place that they can ask for advice. And with Offline First, we tried to make this. We created a website, I will show it to you in a second, to kind of spark the discussion. But they also had very interesting ideas. So my favorite is the Runkeeper for Fish application, like for anglers in the Norwegian wilderness, and also like the point of sale applications, for example, that I mentioned before. But there were kind of a few themes that we've heard over and over again, and I just want to give you an overview. How am I in time? Sorry. Sorry? Okay. 1 minute? Okay. So, let me just jump through this really quick. Okay, I just go through the user stories. I mean, you can just take this from the slides, but I think these are very interesting because they come from a lot of sources. And maybe like these are interesting stories that you should consider when you build offline first apps. So as an app user, I want to be sure that my data is actually there when I need it. So who of you is doing like the screenshotting thing? You know, like, for example, when I'm here, the first thing I do is I make a screenshot of the directions for Google Maps because I don't trust it that it will still work. The other problem is the always online architecture. So as a mobile user, when I'm offline, I want to be able to use features that don't really require a connection. Like this is something I think that every one of us experienced. It just shows me a loader or something, and it just doesn't make any sense. Like I don't understand why it does that, right? As a mobile user, I want to have my personal data on my device at all times. I mean, it's my own data. I'm usually, you know, the one who authored it. So why shouldn't be there? Like, why should I require to load it from some other place if it has been on my phone, for example, before? I want my data always with me and always accessible. There is an interesting thing or an interesting opportunity about applications being smart. So, for example, offline apps. If I come to Boston, my app could figure out, like, hey, you live in Zurich, now you're in Boston. I probably download the surroundings of Google Maps for you because you probably get out and want to use it. Stuff like that could be very interesting. Or like RSS readers figuring out that, hey, I'm commuting starting 8 a.m. in the morning, so maybe download the latest news at 7. Stuff like this. Offline first challenges, and I will end with this, is, as I said, what's not hard is the tech. So you can just go play with it, do it, and you will find a lot of interesting challenges. The technology is not so hard, but you will realize that there is all kind of crazy stuff that you need to inform the user about. Like there is no save, there is no sync, and you need to decide if you want to inform the user, is there a change that is not persisted locally yet? Is it persisted locally? Does it have a change that has not been synced yet? Is there a conflict? Stuff like this, problems that you did not have before, but you have now. Oh yeah. So maybe I end with this, you know. We should get over this. Like, we all know that this loader doesn't say anything. We all know that it's just a lie, really. It's just saying, you know, I'm doing something and it's too complex to explain it to you. So please. Don't panic, use hoodie.